History is made at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, and every year a new May dawns to add to the legacy that is the Indianapolis 500.
50 years ago, a youngster by the name of A.J. Foyt made his first appearance at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, and the perfect person to help us celebrate this moment is Mr. Tom Carnegie.
Certainly a wonderful, wonderful opening day. And again, thanks to all of you fans for being here today to record and be in on a very historic moment. As we salute from Houston, Texas, A.J. Foyt.
Good to have you with us today. Jacques Lazier says, I want to be first on the racetrack.
There are plenty of storylines during the first 2 days in May as rookies and some returning veterans show IndyCar officials they're ready to let it loose on the first day of full practice on Tuesday. The rookie class is light for 2007. Phil Giebler has found an IndyCar ride after working up through the Indy Pro Series ranks. And there's plenty of attention on newcomer Milka Duno from Venezuela. She's quickly a fan favorite.
When I was coming for the day, everybody, Milka! We love you. It was incredible. It made me feel so welcome in my first time in Indianapolis.
Milka Duno, over 210 miles an hour. Last time by, 214. So she's completed those laps over 210 miles an hour and above that. So congratulations to Milka Duno now coming down the main straightaway.
But as a newcomer, she has no fantasies about the job ahead.
It's very, very difficult track. I understand now how the other drivers say it's the most difficult track in the world, really it is. But I have a good people around me that helped me so much. I was listening all the advice for everyone around me, from Alonso, from Pancho Carter, for all my guys in the team, and this made me feel confident.
Among the veterans completing refresher laps, one feel-good story stands out.
And back on the racetrack is Davey Hamilton. He is one of the drivers who must complete a refresher test here at the Speedway.
Hamilton has waited 7 years to climb back in an Indy car after a horrific crash at Texas in 2001. The years of rehabilitation have paid off as he works on getting back up to speed at Indy.
It's been a long time coming. You know, I don't know if I really was vocal about wanting to get back in the car because I didn't know the reactions to a lot of people, from my family to, you know, the owners and sponsors and everything else. But man, I got that bug, starting work with Cheever and doing radio and two-seaters and being around it. My feet were doing so good and coming along so great that, Hewlett Packard believed in me and Tony George believed in me in Vision Racing. And it's just been, you know, dream come true, back to where I really want to be.
Speed is the name of the game as drivers take to the track on Tuesday for the first day of open practice.
And we have a new quick lap, Dan Weldon.
Scott Dixon even quicker now, Jerry. This is getting interesting.
So the Ganassi boys showing their stripes.
The first race at Indy is the race for the pole, and three heavyweight teams will spar throughout the week before duking it out on pole day for the right to pace the field on race day. Defending champion Sam Hornish Jr. won the pole last year with Team Penske. But the 1 mile per hour speed advantage he and teammate Elio Castroneves enjoyed a year ago is gone as the other teams catch up. The race for the pole will be much tougher this year. Andretti Green Racing changes complexion for 2007 as Danica Patrick joins Marco and Michael Andretti, Tony Kanaan and Dario Franchitti in a 5-car Indy effort. Keeping that large stable up to speed will be a tall order. Tony Kanaan is enlisted as a test driver, jumping in the different cars to work on baseline setups. Over at Team Ganassi, 2005 Indy champion and current IndyCar points leader Dan Weldon is quick out of the box. He, along with Scott Dixon, will be the rabbits for week one. Three super teams, 9 cars. Any one of them could sit on the pole come Saturday.
Well, Scott Dixon even quicker now, Jerry. 226.4. This is getting interesting.
To add to the pressure of pole day, only 11 cars will make the field on the first qualification day. Assuming the top nine do well, the battle to start up front will be intense for the last two first day spots. No month of May would be complete without a little rain and a few drivers finding the edge of the envelope.
And there's the 19 machine of John Herb on the hook. Well, they got a lot of work to do on that baby.
Happily, none of the on-track problems are serious. And for the first time in 3 years, the forecast is for sunshine all the way through pole weekend. The sun shines bright on pole day in Indianapolis. Tennis great Billie Jean King drops by to wave the green flag on morning practice and make a little history in front of the pagoda.
Lynn St. James is trying to get me here since 92 when she was Rookie of the Year. And I got here, it was so interesting that there have three women, because I didn't know. I had no idea that Danica and Milka and Sarah would be in it. It's just been fabulous. The media have been great. The fans, you could just tell. Obviously, it's building up because this is qualifying, but it's been a great experience so far, but I'm looking forward to the rest of the day and seeing those cars whiz by. They go so fast.
She waves the green flag on a very busy morning practice session. When the checkered flag comes out, Tony Kanaan has thrown down the gauntlet with the best speed of the day.
Four laps. 16 turns. 10 miles. The run for the pole at Indy is one of the most pressure-packed experiences in all of sports. A glorious day in central Indiana to see this new pole day format finally play out.
Under the new rules, only the first 11 spots will be decided today. More importantly, drivers can take up to 3 runs at the pole if they have the guts to pull their car out of the field and re-qualify.
Race fans, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway is open for qualification.
First on the track is 2004 500 champion Buddy Rice. Buddy's been struggling for speed all week.
Four lap average 221.766. Congratulations to A1 Team USA and Buddy Rice.
It will take better than that to keep him in the field today. Scott Dixon rolls out next, and the first challenge for the pole comes early. Dixon topped the speed charts on Thursday and Friday and was third quick in the morning practice.
The average 224.3 for Scott Dixon. That puts him number one right now.
But Dixon knows he won't be there long.
We just missed, you know, we had so much understeer I had to lift on three of the four laps, so. Not such a good run, but I think the car's definitely got some speed. You know, I felt quite comfortable until that happened, and you know, we'll pick it up, come out later today, and hopefully go for the pole.
Ryan Briscoe follows him out in what many consider a third Penske team car. The yellow number 12 team is managed by Roger's son, Jay.
Checkered flag waving for 25-year-old Ryan Briscoe, our third qualifier today. And he did it. He takes over the number one spot. Ryan Briscoe did it.
Two cars later, Indy's next pole challenger pulls out.
Look who's on track. He has dominated on the IndyCar series this year. Now it's time to see if he has what it takes to sit on the pole position at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. The pressure is on. Dan Weldon is on the course.
But after dominating practice all week long, Team Ganassi is missing the mark on pole day. Weldon knows it's going to be a long one.
The Honda engines are all real equal, so you know, it's just about getting the best out of it, and we didn't quite do that. For that speed that we were doing, I was hanging on a little bit too much. So we'll go back to the drawing board. There's no need to panic just yet. You'll get through the line very quickly, and we'll see what we got.
The 11-car pole day field starts to fill in. Eight are qualified before the first and ready green car gets its shot. Danica Patrick draws the first slot. All five AGR cars should be fast, so pole day bumping is about to begin.
Ladies and gentlemen, the driver of car number 7, the Motorola machine, second fastest in practice today. She's got a shot at winning the pole. Danica on track now. Here she comes.
Unfortunately, Patrick's car is not cooperating.
We'll figure out what the difference was here, and we'll see if it's, we'll see if it's worth redoing it or not. But, at the end of the day, we have 500 miles to do, and we have to do a lot more than 10 miles. So, I don't know. We'll see how it goes. We'll see how the rest of the field ends up. And, I wouldn't be surprised if other people go back out again. So, we'll see.
The pressure of pole day starts showing when Vitor Mira aborts his run as just the 10th qualifier of the day.
Wave off, one strike. So under the new format, Vitor would have two more shots later today as they wave it off. They don't want to be bumped right now.
Being bumped isn't Tony Kanaan's concern, but with the day heating up, getting the setup right for a pole speed is a moving target.
Green flag would be second time by, four to completion. Give me a number. Let them all shoot for it, baby.
You're looking good today.
Tony Kanaan now takes over the pole position. The four-lap average, 224.618. He's number one. Yeah. Tony Kanaan did it.
He's on the pole, but for how long?
Dario Franchitti now on the pole. His average speed, 225.191. That puts him number one.
Franchitti surprises many with the first run of the day at over 225 miles an hour. Less than an hour into qualifying, and the pole day grid is full.
There's a long way to go, but I'm happy because that's one of our best, if not the best, four-lap average we pulled all month. So, I'm gauging on last year. We weren't even in the fight last year with any of the Andretti green cars, and it seems we all are this year. So, a lot of hard work's gone into that. All the guys in the team have busted their ass, so I'm feeling good about it.
Franchitti becomes a spectator as the pole day bumping begins.
A.J. Foyt, the fourth, bumped from the field.
Buddy Rice becomes our second bump of the day.
Congratulations to Jeff Simmons, Koski Matsura. Bump from the field.
So all five AGR cars currently sit in the top five. So they're off to a pretty good start, and some games being played down there by Team Penske.
All right, they said they're pulling out when you go, so I'll just see you later in the day. Okay. Have fun.
The team decided to pull away from the line. I guess we know what we have and go out there and try our best.
It's going to be an interesting day, I think. All right, I'll see you later.
All right, thanks, man.
502 to control and directors. 2-6 will be our last car. The 6 is going to pull out of line. We're going to get a break in the line and open for practice. And I need a pit lane clearance.
It's the right decision to make right now. Roger and Tim, talked it out, decided what they wanted to do, and Elio and I are glad to go along with it.
Well, you look at the draw. We'll get a chance here to go out and practice for a little while. And it's been a little bit slower than maybe what everybody anticipated. And it looks like today you might need 3 shots.
Dario Franchitti will have to wait.
Green flag. The track is now open for practice.
225.039 for Elio. If he could put 4 laps together and average 225.2, he would be the provisional pole sitter.
Well, we just got to look at Team 7-Eleven, Tony Kanaan. And you got to ask yourself what that's all about, because he's sitting in the middle of the front row right now.
225.163 for Sam Hornish Jr.
The yellow flag being displayed, time for a track inspection.
At 4:12 in the afternoon, Elio Castroneves roars off the qualifying line and sets his sights on knocking Dario Franchitti off the pole.
Checkered flag waving for Elio Castroneves. Third lap down a little bit. Fourth lap down a little bit as well. Elio in the middle of row number one.
20 minutes later, Sam Hornish Jr. makes his assault on the top spot.
Let's check him out. 39.880 the speed. It's good enough for the pole position, 225.676. There he is, Sam Hornish Jr., 225.676. Three to go, Scott, three to go. And the speed, 225.465. He's second. Dario holds on to the pole for now. Our spotter's telling us that Sam came oh so close to the wall in that second lap.
And very close, as you mentioned, as we see the replay on the video boards here. And Elio said that his car was quite loose, and whoa!
Look out for that ball. Beautiful job by Sam Hornish Jr.
Hornish knows he has the speed, and two more shots at the pole.
Let's get in line.
The six car looks to be withdrawing that last run. They're gonna go for the pole again.
Hornish could be sitting on the front row at Indy, but Roger Penske withdraws Sam's second quick time to take another run at Franchitti.
Here comes Sam Hornish Jr. Did he get the pole position? Checkered flag for Sam Hornish Jr. No, he did not.
Franchitti has survived, but now everyone knows the speed is out there. As the shadows start creeping across the front stretch, practice speeds start to edge up. The pole day chess game continues. Team Ganassi hopes they have found their lost speed. Both Dixon and Weldon withdraw their earlier runs. Dixon comes close, while Weldon loses ground. Time slows to a crawl for Dario Franchitti as the 6 o'clock gun gets closer. With 8 minutes left, Team Penske withdraws the number three of Elio Castroneves. Earlier, Hornish showed he had the speed. Now it's up to Castroneves to seal the deal.
Elio Castroneves, checkered flag is waving. Did he do it? Did he do it? Yes, he did. Castroneves is on the pole.
Dario Franchitti's hope to pace the Indianapolis 500 is crushed. Penske times Castroneves' run nearly perfectly, but Andretti Green has just enough time before the gun sounds for one last bonsai run to try and take back the pole. Tony Kanaan is the natural choice. He's qualified in the top five every year he's raced in the 500.
Grab this thing by the tail and make it yours.
Tony Kanaan, green flag waving. TK, show us what you got. Here we go. Oh my goodness, listen to this, 225.882. Tony Kanaan is fast enough to grab the pole position.
The gun has fired to end the day, but on track is Tony Kanaan, two-lap average of 225.939. He is on a pole run here, the final run of the day. Down the front straight, one of the final laps of the day to be turned here. How fast will it be? The white flag is out, still fast enough at 225.890 as Tony Kanaan on the final lap of the day. Here's Tony Kanaan. He needs a lap at better than 225.8. Will he get it? Checkered flag is out. He didn't do it. Elio Castroneves holds on.
Castroneves celebrates his second pole at Indy. The third time's the charm for the new qualifying format at Indy, and it's definitely been worth the wait.
It's just incredible. You know, we had a great weather, obviously incredible fans, and I tell you, man, we were like right to the end, you know, trying everything, every little bit, and wow, what an incredible day, and I can't thank Team Penske enough for this day.
You know, it was a good run. We took a chance this morning, we got the cars right, and this format played into our hand. What a finish.
One day after the incredible excitement of pole day, only 11 more spots go up for grabs. With the new qualifying rules, every day is a bump day. Scott Sharp found out the hard way. He got bumped yesterday, but will be the first out again today.
Same procedures again, going out on the racetrack. They'll wave the green flag second time by to start your attempt. Four laps to completions. You get three attempts again today on it. Green flag would be your first attempt on this car for the day. Go out there and give me four good ones, and let's have a good day.
Scott Sharp becomes our first qualifier on day number two. Here's the checkered flag.
But, you know, we just keep whittling away on the car. We almost had enough yesterday afternoon. If we kind of just got it maybe to turn a little bit better, we would have knocked Michael out. So, you know, it's like I said all along, we came to this month thinking we weren't going to win the qualifying battle, but we have a good chance to maybe win the main race while we're all here.
They are. When you're ready, track is ready.
Thank you.
You know, with this new qualifying format, it's really a different strategy. I mean, you go out and run what you can. We were wide open there. You know, we know the car's been to 222, and we know we can get it to 222 here today if we need to, and we want to. But yeah, I think you run what you can, and then you sit back and do some adjustments and see where you need to be. So it's a whole new strategy these days. It's pretty cool. I think it's exciting.
And nerve-wracking. Lazier will be forced to re-qualify when Buddy Rice bumps him out of the top 22 later in the day. Davey Hamilton hopes he's found the speed he needs for his Vision Racing entry.
You know, this new qualifying setup thing, I'm not so sure about it. I just want to stay in the top 11 today. And I think we're pretty solid at that. But, yeah, it's great, man, to go 6 years. 6 years out of a car, 8 days straight in the car. I'm ready for a break.
You know, we're doing 12 to 22. We're full on those, so your bump is 219.906.
She's fine.
Checkered flag waving for Sarah Fisher back in the field at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. She did it.
It was on the edge, you know? I mean, that's as much as I can hang on to. It was sideways and two a couple times, but, you know, that's a part of qualifying here. And, you know, we tried to keep it as neutral as we could without it binding up because of sliding. So, you know, that's where it was.
Fisher's run will stand. She bumps John Herb, who bumps back in later in the day.
You know, we're kind of running out of time today, so, but here, you know, I am in 22nd spot, but I'm on the bubble. So, words I didn't want to hear ever, on the bubble.
Buddy, same procedure as earlier, right up on the racetrack. Start your second attempt. 221.070 is your number.
Checkered flag waving for Buddy Lazier. He did it. He's in the field. He bumps John Herb.
Lazier's run kicks Herb to the curb for the second time. He'll have to try to find more speed next weekend. But with just 11 spots remaining, there will be added pressure. A whole new set of competitors is waiting in the wings to take to the track. When week two of practice starts on Wednesday, Panther Racing adds a car to its stable and ends a 13-year Indy 500 absence for John Andretti, who admits things have changed a bit.
Yeah, when I get in the car, it's a lot more stuff to look at and stuff to work on and stuff you can do. And that's not always good from a driver's standpoint, or at least from an engineering standpoint, because then you can get in and mess a lot of things up. But I told him, I said, if I can just get out of pit lane, I will be extremely happy, because from there on, it's just driving a race car again.
Some new but familiar faces show up to try and make the show. All have Indy experience and they'll need it. They've already missed a week of practice. Time is running out to find speed.
Yellow, yellow. Jimmy Kite has made contact with the wall.
Doesn't appear to be a great deal of damage on the car. It's like he was just a little low in the corner. And in any case, Jimmy Kite out of the car appears to be okay. The number 18 machine damaged on the left front. Kite is philosophical about his bumpy return to the speedway.
It was great up until turn one on that last lap. It was fun being back out there. I mean, it really was. First time you come off turn four and look down the front straightaway, and it's like, wow, okay. Yeah, it's nice to be back. This is fun. But, you know, just turn one just reminded me how cruel this place can be sometimes.
Stefan Gregoire sets out to make his eighth Indy 500, racing for Chastain Motorsports. Gregoire's short May ends in the doctor's office. A cracked vertebrae will keep him out of the cockpit. With time running out, veteran Roberto Moreno is named to fill in for the injured Gregoire. Day three of qualifying is full of activity. The track fills with cars already in the race, working hard on race setups. All the traffic makes it even harder for second week drivers to get their cars set up to qualify.
Do the same stuff you did, go out there. Don't get excited, it's just you, the car, and the racetrack. This is the best situation, don't be nervous. Go out there, second time by, hit your marks. Don't turn in early, you're in good shape, give me four good ones, put her in the show and do a good job.
The checkered flag for
Melcaduno.
Just a couple of turns to go before John Andretti is back at the Indianapolis 500.
And here comes the checkered flag for Al Unser Jr. It's the best lap yet, 221.634.
RPM in three, so I went down to fifth in the short shoot.
By happy hour, eight more drivers have made the field. Just three spots remain. Some teams are still looking for speed. Some think they've found it.
You can't take anything for granted here. It's very, very special to be able to make this field. I think we're pretty solidly in, so I'm ecstatic about that.
Again, the slowest speed in the field right now, Canada's Marty Roth at 218.922. Milkaduno is next at 219.228. But Phil Giebler can keep this run intact. He is not going to have any worries at all. And once again, lap number three is over 221 miles an hour at 221.061. Mark James, Phil Giebler is already in turn two.
Out of the shadows of the sweets at turn two, Phil Giebler just about. Oh, he touched the wall at the exit of turn two. Had a great run underway, and he brushed the wall at the exit of two. A very high exit and heavy damage to the car as it swings to the inside and comes to rest inside the back straightaway.
The Playa del Racing team will have a long night ahead of them. As time runs out on the third day of qualifications, Roberto Moreno and Jimmy Kite are added to the grid.
He is our 32nd qualifier, and we have one spot remaining to be filled.
No bump day at Indy would be complete without a driver showing up at the last minute to make the show on the final day. Hearn takes just 42 laps to shake the car down before taking it out to qualify.
Richie, welcome back. Certainly wish you had more track time, what you got going right now, but it is what it is.
But it was good enough. Phil Giebler gets a redo in the newly rebuilt 31 car. This time, he makes it stick.
Giebler will complete the run, and it looks like Jimmy Kite is going to be bumped from the lineup. There's the checkered flag.
And right now, on the bubble goes Roberto Moreno. Roberto Moreno decides he doesn't like sitting on the bubble. He withdraws a 216 run from the day before and re-qualifies the 77 car.
A gutsy move that paid off for the Chastain Motorsports team, and Roberto Moreno, he is in the field, and he saved himself some 4 miles per hour. Man, he has got to be ecstatic.
We knew we needed at least a 2.95.
After a lot of difficulty.
And as soon as we got the car comfortable enough to do that, and we were doing a 2.20, we said, okay, guys, time to go. Let's try it.
Roth sweats it out, but neither Jimmy Kite nor P.J. Jones can find the speed necessary to mount a challenge for the grid. The starting field for the 91st running of the Indianapolis 500 is set. The week leading up to the race is a whirlwind of activity as drivers barnstorm across the country making media appearances.
I mean, it's awesome, you know, to have everybody like cheering your name. Some of the guys actually like, hey man, I'm even if they say Julio Helio, well, I don't care right now at this point. It's nice to see a different environment. And but you know what? I feel comfortable wearing my helmet. Not in the street like this, but close to a race car, and that's where I belong.
Even on the road, the race is on every driver's mind.
This week, I'd say, is the toughest of the month, only because, you know, we're very stressed because we don't know what kind of car we're going to have underneath us come carb day. We know we only have a couple laps to sort it out. So
this has probably been the most stressful month I've ever had at Indianapolis in terms of, you know, performance. And obviously you can't really do much carburation day. But I think the clearest view you get of where everybody's at on those first few laps.
We've got a lot of commitments to get through and a lot of late dinners and things like that. And I think once you start to get tired and then you start thinking more about the race, it does kick in. You get a little bit more, you know, more nervous, especially once you do the parade, because you know it's straight after that.
The big thing for me is just, you know, I'm excited to go and race. The best part about being a race car driver is actually racing the car, not practicing, not, you know, doing all the interviews, all that stuff. It's you know, being in the car and racing. And I always look forward to that. Obviously, I wish it would come around quicker, but it's, you got to wait.
I'm definitely, you know, in amongst the fast cars, but it's like one day the car is good and one day it's not, so it seems to be tough to really nail down the setup. It's probably going to be a little bit of luck on that day and a little bit of watching the conditions and just hoping that you make the right choice.
Hey man, how are you?
Good, how are you today?
Thank you.
The starting field drops by the Speedway on Wednesday to sign some autographs for Community Day. But by Friday, it's back to business for a busy Miller Lite Carb Day. In the morning, IndyCar teams get one last chance to shake down their cars and break in new motors before Sunday's race. Tony Kanaan takes top speed honors in practice as the IndyCars make way for a race, the Freedom 100 for the Indy Pro Series drivers. Alex Lloyd keeps his 2007 winning streak intact with a victory in the Freedom 100. It's a party atmosphere as the IndyCar drivers return to finish the day in the annual Checkers Rallies pit stop competition.
And remember, it's all about the time in the pits. It's all about the time in the pits. You know what's going to happen?
Elio takes it to the fence in triumph. There will be plenty of celebration and parties in the next 2 days, but things are about to get serious. The greatest spectacle in racing is less than 48 hours away.
Sure hope this rain holds off. We'll get it done in the first couple hours.
To what I'm looking at, we're into this hole now. What do you have out there?
Coming out!
Hey, is this race day?
Say yeah!
Well, we're looking pretty good right now. The weather's cleared. We're anticipating an on-time start and looking forward to all 500 miles.
Tell him you've been here longer than me.
Come on, man. Congratulations on
that. Sure. Making his fifth start from Emberton, England, Dan Weldon.
Sam,
after battling the track all morning, the crews win round one with Mother Nature.
If 3 hours ago you told me we were going to be on time for the start of the 91st 500, I would have laughed at you.
It's a tribute to the track workers, hard at it, all the way to race time.
502, I don't know if we've got hand blowers or what we can do, but something we can deal with it after they leave.
10-4, fire control is working on it. Stand by for the command.
Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines!
Command has been given. Command has been given.
Corvette pace car beginning to pull away. What's up with Elio Castaneves' car?
Tim, we're not fired.
Push the three to the left side of the grid. Push the three to the left side of the grid.
The rest of the field pulling away.
And there's the roar of the engine, and he is away.
All right, we got that out of the way. Good job, guys.
Car is running, they're pushing away. Tell the 3 and the 91 to pick warm-up lanes at the ends to pass up. Copy. pace car is at 9.5. We're going one to go at the line.
Elio Castroneves reclaims his spot behind the pace car, driven by Patrick Dempsey.
Okay, pace car is going to go to 105 down the back.
Okay, get ready here, Chief. Get ready, big guy.
They're making their way through the north end, fans on their feet, waving hats, ready for the start of the 91st running of the Indianapolis 500.
They are in the short chute, and Elio Castroneves down along the white line. He has the lead. He will lead Kanaan and Franchitti to you, Mike King.
Peyton Manning will throw the green flag. We're racing in Indianapolis. Elio Castroneves, the leader in one.
It's just like they lined up, Mike King. Elio Castroneves, then Tony Kanaan, then Dario Franchitti, and Scott Dixon. They're already in turn two.
Same way through here. A few cars throwing some sparks. The number two car, Schechter, makes a pass on the outside as they head for the backstretch.
He has TK in tow. A hard dive to the white line to the inside. Castroneves by two car lengths over Kanaan.
They're in the short chute now down along the white line. Left side rubber in the middle of the track is Castroneves. Kanaan right on the outside. He's going to make the pass.
Tony Kanaan will go side by side with Elio Castroneves. He'll be the leader as we now head to turn number one.
And he does make the pass, Mike King. Tony Kanaan settled the pole in 05, finished second in 04, and he has got himself a good size lead in front of Bob Jenkins.
Already a lead change in the Indy 500. Kanaan stretches it out by about five car lengths through the second corner.
Kanaan not wasting any time with Elio in tow. Then it's Dario Franchitti, Sam Hornish Jr., Scott Dixon, Dan Weldon, your top five as they roar out of turn number three in the short chute the north end.
Kanaan has about a three car length lead on Castroneves. He's down along the white line. Castroneves behind three cars. Here they come, Mike.
Tony Kanaan wasted little time getting to the front for the sixth consecutive start. He has led here at Indy, but here comes Elio back in turn number one.
He sets up on the outside, Mike, and makes the pass like Kanaan was standing still. Is Castroneves back in front one more time?
The crowd is loving it here in turn two. Castroneves back in the lead by now about seven car lengths over Kanaan. Everybody through turn two looking good.
Interestingly enough, the advantage that TK had through here the last time is the same advantage that Elio now is enjoying. Great move by Dan Weldon. Worked his way around Marco Andretti and Scott Dixon. Weldon grabs the fifth spot in turn four.
That lead is about seven cars for Castroneves, and now Sam Hornish Jr. right on the tail of Dario Franchitti.
Tony Kanaan is the leader of these clubs last time by Elio Castroneves, will be still the leader with three left to complete of the 200 will run. Tony Kanaan runs second, Dario Franchitti is third, Sam Hornish Jr. is fourth, Dan Weldon runs fifth.
Outside, outside.
And look at Tony Kanaan, he regains the lead. So Kanaan and Castroneves.
Tony Kanaan in the 7-Eleven machine will come across the yard of bricks. He'll lead lap number four, Jerry Baker, by two car lengths and one.
That green and white car in front of the red and white car. They have separated themselves from the third place car of Dario Franchitti over in the second corner.
Both of those guys are indeed stretching out their advantage over Dario Franchitti just a bit. Castroneves still has Kanaan in his sights as they head to three.
All these guys look like they're trying to outrace the rain. They are on it like this is a 50-lap sprint race.
There's action everywhere as drivers test their early setups. By lap 11, the field starts to settle down.
So the front runners have strung themselves out just a bit. They're going single file. 10 laps complete. Here is your top 10 in the 91st Indianapolis 500. Tony Kanaan, Elio Castroneves, Dario Franchitti, Sam Hornish Jr., and Dan Weldon. Then you've got Marco Andretti, Scott Dixon, Thomas Schechter is eighth, Ryan Briscoe is ninth, and Danica Patrick runs 10.
Cooper debris, pits are closed, 11's the lead. The debris in turn three. Turn three. Spotters in three. You see the debris right in front of you. The meter is off the 3-3 car. It's off the 3-3 car.
Once the pits open, no one will stay out. A rain-washed green racetrack means extra tire wear. And everyone needs a little work on their car setup. Well, almost everyone.
Tell me, how's the car? A little bit of the huge turn one, but it's because of the wind a little bit. Nothing that I cannot manage, but a little bit more than I would like to have, but it's okay for now.
All right, Elio, if we come in here, what do you need?
Well, right now, I'll probably be staggered, but yeah, probably, because of traffic.
Pits are open, we will pit now. Coming in. You probably see the cars go way too much under steer.
Reset your fuel, it can be quick here, Elio. Reset your fuel and watch rig. Wet right in front of you. Turn up, go. All right, get to the right. Good job.
A great
Great pit stop for Helio Castroneves. He gets out first. Helio Castroneves will take the lead with a pit stop under 8 seconds. Tony Kanaan got out second, and then it's Sam Hornish Jr.
Green, green, green.
And right now, Tony Kanaan caught right in the middle of the Penske sandwich.
It doesn't take long till Kanaan and Castroneves are back at it, battling at the point.
And Castroneves and Kanaan have once again pulled away from the field. Now Kanaan goes to the outside to make the pass.
They're side by side. Tony Kanaan will once again get past Helio Castroneves into turn number one.
And Castroneves now pulls right up on him, but falls back again very quickly. So right now it's Tony Kanaan leading the way in the second turn.
What a show these two are putting on. First one leads, then the other.
While Kanaan and Castroneves slug it out for the lead, Dario Franchitti is battling a car that wants to go to the wall.
Thing is understeer like a tank. Okay, we're working.
Tony Kanaan, second place back in 2004. More than anything, he wants to win this race. He's trying to hold off Castroneves.
Boy, here comes Helio. He's going to go side by side with Kanaan. Less than a half a car length. Helio will make the pass, heading into one.
He did it on the outside, Mike. He kind of dodged to the inside. Kanaan saw him in his mirrors, got out of the way, and now it's Castroneves up front again.
We had expected this all month long. Penske against AGR. Right now, Penske is the lead once again.
Back in sixth, Dario Franchitti's in trouble. Dario Franchitti loses ground, but teammate Marco Andretti sails to the front.
Watching Marco Andretti on the track side by side with the six car. With the six car right now. He's battling Sam Hornish Jr. for third. That was for third. Marco Andretti moving up. Tony Kanaan now falling back behind Sam Hornish Jr. This field. Very racy, side by side to go. Castroneves and Marco, 1-2.
In the last lap and a half, he has gone from sixth to second, making a three wide pass and then getting past Sam Hornish Jr. This guy is right now hooked up. Whoa, we've got a car in the wall. Problem in turn number one.
Car coming to a stop right directly in front of me. It is Roberto Moreno. Heavy right side damage to the car.
Marco Andretti's charge to the front is interrupted by Moreno's misfortune. But as fast as the number 26 car seems to be, Castroneves seems comfortable leading the Indianapolis 500.
Need any changes?
Negative.
3, 2, 1.
That's about to change in a big way.
Reset your fuel. Reset your fuel. Watch Rick here. Watch Rick.
Fuel's not blowing.
Fuel's not blowing, guys.
There's a huge problem in the Helio Castroneves pit.
They're working now. They're blowing. Reset. Recock it. Recock it. Take it in and take it out. Now put it back in. Put it back in. Is it flowing? Find the seal. We need to change the hose. Do we get fuel in or not?
Full. We are full.
All right, Helio, got a little work to do now.
Hey, you guys want to stop and put some down force or not?
Yeah, that might be a good idea.
Plus two turns.
Helio goes from first to worst in one pit stop. Crew Chief Tim Cendrick works to keep everybody focused on the new situation.
Guys, be cool. Be cool.
Okay, I'm back. Back straight away. I'm going to pit this lap, okay?
It's in for pit this lap.
Are we changing tires or not?
No, we'll leave the same tires, Helio. Same tires. Guys, we'll do the rear wing, up half turn front wing.
Coming in.
Meanwhile, the race leader is young Marco Andretti.
Marco Andretti had a great stop, another 8-second pit stop. There were no changes. He's very happy with the car, but on his last stop, they had a little right front wing, and that may be what got him going there. This kid's on a mission today.
Crew Chief Kyle Moyer knows he has a hungry warrior on his hands.
Marco is really standing up in the seat out there. What'd you do to get him going so good?
Oh, we haven't done anything, really. I mean, the thing was understeering, but we knew it was with the green track, and we're trying to set them down instead of getting them going, you know? we didn't lead the last lap, and we don't, you know, these laps don't count for a win. So as long as we can lead 200, we just want to set them down, get a good pace, get Tony back up there, and our teammates to protect us.
Kanaan, unfortunately, is surprised to find a pair of Team Ganassi drivers in front of him after his pit stop.
Hey, George, do you think those guys are saving more fuel than I am? Because we lost a lot of positions. Yeah, I know. Two positions, but Marco short filled, and I wouldn't be surprised those other guys did either.
Nice stuff. That was awesome.
We didn't do a half a turn in front wing because we wanted to jump our neighbors who were doing it.
When the green flag comes out to start lap 44, Marco Andretti sees nothing but red in his rearview mirror.
Dixon has closed the gap on Marco Andretti, about a two-car length advantage for Marco.
So here comes Marco Andretti across the yard of bricks, but Jerry Baker, here comes Dixon to the inside in one.
And he will make the first inside pass we've seen so far today. Mike King, Dixon out in front and standing on that baby.
What a difference that clean air makes for the leader, really able to stretch it out. Already a six-car length advantage for Scott Dixon at the set of a three. Meanwhile, Dan Weldon has his sights set on Marco Andretti.
Yeah, Marco Andretti has some problems right now because he's got Weldon behind him two car lengths. Then it's Sam Hornish Jr. and Tony Kanaan.
A savvy pit stop is paying off for Dixon as he leads the field. While a half lap away, Elio Castroneves is roaring through the back markers.
Watch Castroneves trying to work through the field now. Told you he dropped all the way back in the middle of the pack. He's 26th right now.
And we got a problem in turn number two, Bob Jenkins.
Car hit the wall in turn number one. It slides along the outside wall. It's John Herb.
John Herb brings out the race's third yellow on lap 52. But more importantly, rain is on the way. And by the time the next green flag falls, there will be only 40 laps left to an official race. Crew chiefs up and down pit row start getting creative.
What are we doing here?
Come here, you got any changes?
No change.
All right, pits are open. Hey, your tires okay?
No, change tires.
Okay, you sure? I was just trying to get you to the spot.
Okay, leave the tires.
10-4, you want them.
Okay, we're gonna follow the leader here. We'll follow the leader. Core following the leader.
We'll pit on this lap, Scott. We will pit.
Pit on this lap.
Oh, coming in this lap, coming in.
Stay out, Tony, stay out. Tony, follow the leader, right? Affirmative. Coming in. Okay.
Dixon's crew delivers a flawless performance.
Good job, boys. Good job. You guys are smoking.
AGR's decision to leave Kanaan out on old tires and less than a half load of ethanol could come back to bite them. Farther back, Tim Cendrick's strategy picks up seven spots for Elio, but his old tires could make it tough to fight through the front half of the field. And quietly running an eighth, Dario Franchitti gets his first report of what is to come.
Just a bit of info. Tony is in the lead, and the first three cars did not fit. That stand behind you. Denninger in front. How many laps have we done? We're working 57, and there's been a report that rain is just under an hour away.
Okay.
Okay, TK, just give you a quick rundown. This lap 56 you just completed. You got three slower cars behind you, and then it starts in on Weldon, Marco, Sam, Danica, Dario. Do a good job. I'll just keep it going here. Good job on that last lap on yellow mileage.
Tony Kanaan is your leader after this latest round, the third round of pit stops during the 500-mile race. So TK is back out in front. Jeff Simmons runs in second place. Buddy Rice runs third. Scott Dixon is fourth, and it is Marco Andretti, who is shown in fifth place.
You got to think about what's going to happen now here. Tony's going to have to take off because he's going to have to pit in 18, 19 laps. So if it stays green all the way through the segment, that puts him almost a lap down when he stops. So he's going to take off big.
We are restarting these 91st Indianapolis 500. 60 laps will be complete. Tony Kanaan is out in front, and they are four wide. Jerry Baker heading to one.
They managed to squeeze that four down to two, which they can get done. And it brought Tony Kanaan on a run.
And there's still two abreast coming through corner number two back in the field. And Marco Andretti once again is on the run and back in fourth spot.
Tony Kanaan, Jess Simmons, Buddy Rice is how they head down the back straightaway. All under the Penske car, Sam Hornick Jr. almost tore up some turf about the midway point of the back straightaway. Went well below the white line.
They are through four, and the guy to watch is Marco Andretti. He got a great jump on the restart. He's in fourth.
Well, this is one wild restart. Tony Kanaan is out in front. Jeff Simmons runs second. Here comes Dixon looking for second and one.
Dixon will stick it right down inside. Those left side wheels on the white line. They may move out in the middle of the short shooting in the front of Bob Jenkins.
And now we have Jeff Simmons in between Scott Dixon and the third place Marco Andretti as they race through the corner. And Mark, head to you.
Marco Andretti right up on Jeff Simmons, trying to make the pass before he gets to turn three. Can't get it done. Meanwhile, smooth sailing for Tony Kanaan in the end of the three.
Yeah, he has a huge advantage now, about 15 car lengths over Scott Dixon. Then you go back to Jeff Simmons. Down on the inside white line is Marco Andretti, a couple of car lengths behind Simmons.
Well, we take a look behind Tony Kanaan, Scott Dixon. Then you've got Jeff Simmons trying to hold off Marco Andretti, but Jerry Baker, he's not going to hold him long.
Andretti will go to the outside, but Simmons has got enough horsepower to hang on to the spot, so Andretti falls back in line.
And now we'll see if Andretti can make the pass coming off the corner. Meanwhile, he has his hands full with Sam Hornish, who's closing in for third place.
Jeff Simmons' car handling very well through turns one and two. He has all kinds of horsepower. Hornish to the inside of Marco. He'll grab the spot at the apex of turn number three.
Kanaan through the short chute, about a 10-car length advantage over Scott Dixon. And then it's Jeff Simmons, but right behind him is last year's winner, Sam Hornish Jr.
Look at Marco challenging again, trying to get around Sam Hornish Jr. Side by side there, they almost touch tires. Sam Hornish Jr. holds his line in turn one.
The jockeying behind them has allowed Kanaan and Dixon to pull away from the pack. But if the track stays green, Scott Dixon knows all he has to do is stay patient.
Tony's got to stop in 10. Let's use him for 10 laps.
It was a good idea in theory.
Milka Duno in the wall in turn number one.
She lost it coming into turn number one. Did a spin right in front of me here. Caught the outside safer barrier and has come to a stop in the middle of turn one, right in the middle of the raceway. Car 23, Milka Duno smacked it hard.
With just a few laps of green flag racing, the leaders can stay out and maintain track position. But it's a luxury Tony Kanaan cannot afford.
Tony, when the pit's open, we're coming in. You didn't like my easy life, but you want to give me some work today. That's okay. Now, I think a lot of people are going to come in, I think. They're basically in the same position they were last time they came in, but I have all the faith in you. I was ever disappointed, you know that.
In addition to Kanaan, AGR opts to bring Marco Andretti in for new tires, leaving Dario Franchitti out as the front man for the team.
Hey, Dario, we're looking for Dixon. We're looking for Dixon. He's behind TK. TK will pit. We want to see what Dixon does. If he comes in, you come in. Now follow Dixon. Follow Dixon. That's affirmative. CNO, I'm CNO. That's the boy. That's good.
Over at Team Penske, Elio Castroneves has decided enough is enough.
How's the car?
Wow, have you know, new tires. It's hard for me to get past.
Think clean air will help you?
No, it's new tires, man.
Tony Kanaan, the leader, comes in. Very easy stop. Four tires, full load of fuel. Slight adjustment on the right front ring.
Marco.
And Wilson was the first out. He did not take tires. Elio Castroneves did take tires.
Scott Dixon, Hornish, Franchitti, top three. Expecting a restart next time by.
After chasing his setup and the lead pack in the early part of the race, Franchitti and crew have finally got their car dialed in. It's Hornish, though, that gets the jump on the restart.
Sam Hornish Jr. to the inside of Scott Dixon. He's going to be the leader in one.
He will indeed take the lead away from Scott Dixon. Dario Franchitti will run third. That's your top three in the turn two.
And it's Dixon running in second position, then Dario Franchitti and Thomas Schechter as Hornish stretches it out.
Well, it's just amazing whenever somebody grabs a spot, they get a big lead. Meanwhile, Dario jumps out of line. He too much wants to make quick work of Scott Dixon. Dusto at the apex at three. Dario Franchitti in second place.
Hornish's lead is about 10 car lengths over Franchitti. Then it's another 10 car lengths back to Dixon, followed by Scheckter and Jacques Lazier. Dario has cut that advantage that Hornish has to about three car lengths. He's right behind him now, down the front straightaway.
Dario Franchitti, the Scotsman, pulls up right to the rear wing, to the inside of Sam Hornish Jr., side by side in one.
And wheel to wheel, and all of a sudden it's Dario Franchitti in that bright orange and black car. He'll take the lead into turn two.
While Franchitti leads, Kanaan is barreling through the field, going from 18th to 8th by lap 83. If everybody stays out of trouble, every car in front of Kanaan must pit soon. Disaster nearly strikes Hornish and Scheckter, but the track stays green.
Heads up for Hornish, he's broke. Heads up for Hornish, he's broke. Hornish has got a problem right there in front of you. You're clear. Hornish went in the pit with a flat. Got Scheckter, he's a little ways back. Thanks, Dave.
It's taken nearly half the race, but the front of the field is facing their first cycle of green flag pit stops.
Pit this lap.
Franchitti is the first to peel off. As the rest of the lead pack comes in for service, Kanaan's late pit stop plays in his favor. He's back in the lead with rain bearing down on the speedway and less than 10 laps to an official race.
We have an incredible view out west here, and it looks like rain is coming. This could wind up being a 10-lap sprint to lap 104 or 105 at this point.
Franchitti comes back out in 16th, desperate to get a handle on how the green flag pit stop shuffle is playing out.
Just put the pedal down. We need some good, quick laps.
96 of 200 laps are being shown complete. The question is, will we run 200 laps here this afternoon? Tony Kanaan is out in front.
How's your car, Tony? How's your car? Okay.
Castro Neves is back in the hunt as well, and on the same pit strategy as race leader Kanaan.
And all the leaders are starting to pit. All the leaders are starting to come in. We got about five more laps to make them count. About five more laps. Do you want any changes?
By lap 98, Kanaan's and Castro Neves' luck seem to have run out. They're both out of ethanol.
Elio, pick this lap, pick this lap.
Crash, yellow.
Watch out, turn two.
Yellow, stay out, Elio.
Hit this lap, Tony. Oh, it's yellow flag, position ain't on fuel, stay out.
Wreck is on the back stretch.
The pits open on lap 100. The race is official in one lap. And for all the drivers know, whoever leads these next few laps could wind up on the BorgWarner Trophy.
Okay, so you're gonna pit here. You are pitting now. No. We got rain coming up here. We don't know. It's about 20 minutes away, they reckon. So pack up and get in there. Okay, coming in.
Tony Kanaan now coming into the pits, along with Marco, Sam Hornish Jr., Danica Patrick in, Elio into the pits. So we're gonna shuffle it out again.
Marco had a very uneventful stop, just 9 seconds, no changes, four tires and fuel. He's now the leader of this race.
We nearly had an incident between two of the Penske cars. Elio Castroneves had to slow and waited for Sam Hornish Jr. to exit his stall. They were able to work it out and no problems there.
Wait. Go. We're P7 right now. The car is just like you started the race now.
Okay.
So the restart among teammates. We'll watch and see how the marching orders go in that situation.
You and Marco are A1 and 2, but you need to get around them because rain is questionable right now. So just try to get out Quantron as quick as you can.
So much for marching orders.
Looks like we may have rain about 10 to 15 minutes away. So she's gonna be a bit of a sprint here for you.
And the green flag waves, here we go. Here they come out of turn number four. Marco Andretti has the lead. Tony Kanaan hanging right with him. Here they come to the start-finish line. Tony Kanaan going to the inside of Marco right now, and he's got the lead. Tony Kanaan grabs the lead. TK to number one. Yellow, we've got problems in turn one. Yellow.
Kanaan's great restart puts the Brazilian right where he had hoped to be, leading the Indianapolis 500. And he may be the only driver on the track actually praying for rain.
It's raining.
where, Tony? Auto's turning four. 10-4, I'll pass it on.
All right. Brinko a little bit here.
No, it's not. No, it's not.
I'm sorry, it was the water from the Mario's car.
George, they cannot even think about it right now, man. Track's getting very wet in turn three. No, they aren't. They're not even thinking. It's wet here. So if it goes red here, go through the pit lane, go all the way down by Elio's pit. There'll be somebody there to stop you.
The red flag flies. Brian Howard has reached for and has picked up the red flag, and he will wave it over this field. Cars on the track, 28 of the 33 starters still running. Tony Kanaan is out in front. From what we're staring out of the pagoda and looking at right now, it looks like we could be looking at the end of the day.
I would think so. It's that people say it takes 2 hours to dry the track once the rain stops, and I doubt very much if we'll see a resumption of this race.
The only thing right now that is steady here is the rain that is falling at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, and we're being told from the National Weather Service to expect somewhere in the neighborhood of 40 to 60 minutes of rain. That puts us to close to 4 o'clock before the rain stops, probably talking about 2.5 hours or so to drive this track. Jake Query just might be standing with the winner of the 91st Indianapolis 500.
Tony Kanaan got out of the car and immediately had a hug from Marco Andretti. Tony Kanaan, talk about the restart, and do you feel you've won the 91st 500?
No, until they threw the checker flag, I can't say I won, but I mean, it's been a great day for us. No matter what happens, I think we proved that we're competitive. Marco is the man. I think he's a great teammate, a true friend. Dario did a great job for us this month, and let's see what's gonna happen. I mean, I haven't got a checker yet, so if they give it to me, fine. If they don't, whatever it's going to be, it's going to be. So I'm ready to go again. If they drive the track, we have a competitive car. So we're going to do another 80-some laps. We'll do it.
I brought it down too slow. That's what might have lost me the race. But I got to say, if I'm going to lose this thing and it's not going to be Dad, that guy's my hero. If I would have known it was going to go yellow right there, I would have made it a little bit more difficult. What can I say? I want to win the Indianapolis 500. Yep.
The puddles continue to grow in pit lane, and a media circus surrounds the man many think has won the Indianapolis 500.
Everybody was following Tony around, Dario. Don't they realize it's your fifth?
TK's leading, though. I'd be following him around, too.
Talk to me about the pit stop. It caught you guys out. You guys were just out of sequence, and it kind of bit you when that caution came out.
Yeah, a little bit. We threw the dice earlier. We had, you know, Tony and I talked a lot about doing this, splitting the strategy, and we did that. And right now it seems to have worked in Tony's favor. I don't know if we will go back to green. I think if it does, Tony looks very strong, but I think we've probably got the second strongest car out there now. We certainly didn't have that at the start of the race. It was pretty ugly.
As ugly as the weather is, race officials are determined to dry the track if at all possible. Radar shows a window between storms big enough to finish the race if crews can get the course dry in time. It's taken 3 hours, but the track is dry.
Started the engines, and 28 drivers will resume the pace.
Pits are open.
A cut tire forces Franchitti to pit. He goes in fifth and comes out in 14th. He said he had the second best car on the track. Now he's going to get a chance to prove it.
Here comes Marco Andretti. He is not going to waste any time. He'll go to the high side of Tony Kanaan. 116 complete, heading to turn number one.
And Tony Kanaan shuts him off, Mike. He took the low road. There's a little bit of a gap back to the third place position, but Kanaan is still out front going into turn two.
Indeed, Kanaan with about a three-car length advantage, two abreast as Elio Castroneves continues to pass cars.
Looked like there was going to be a battle for that third spot. Now we have a battle for the lead. Marco to the high side at PK. Tony watches him whiz by, and Marco leads the way to the short two, the north end.
Marco Andretti in front of a turn four crowd. Nobody has left here, guys. He's got a five-car length lead as he flashes by ahead of Kanaan.
At the line, this will be the 17th lead change of the day. Marco Andretti, Jerry Baker, he's the leader in turn number one.
99% of the people are still here and watching the great race. It's Marco, Kanaan, then Danica Patrick. 1, 2, 3 in turn two.
It is very close, however, up front as Kanaan is not letting Andretti get away by very much. They race toward turn number three with Marco still the advantage.
Really can't see Kanaan till they get upon us. He's going to make a hard dive to the inside to grab the spot. 7-11 machine in first place on the north end.
And Kanaan now has about a three-car length lead on Marco Andretti.
Marco took his best shot at Kanaan and is forced to fall back. Now it's Danica's turn.
Danica Patrick moves across the Arda Bridge. She will overtake her teammate headed to turn number one.
And the crowd goes nuts down here in turn one. Danica Patrick now. She's going to put pressure on Tony Kanaan.
Kanaan proves too strong for Danica. But two cars are cutting through traffic to get to the front. Dan Weldon picks off Elio Castroneves to get up to fourth. And Dario Franchitti has fought his way back from 14th to 7th. And his timing couldn't be better, as the leaders have to pit.
The race leader comes in, Tony Kanaan, into the pits, along with Danica. Kanaan and Danica both coming in for a pit stop. Both in for a pit stop. Castroneves into the pits. Lap 137, the race leaders in for a pit stop. Dario Franchitti, Dario now takes over the lead.
The track stays green, and the different team pit strategies are mixing up the front of the pack. Franchitti has to come in on lap 143.
So with 144 laps complete, Jacques Lazier goes to the front as we continue to see a massive number of lead changes in this, the 91st Indianapolis 500-mile race.
But the Playa del Racing team's rain dance doesn't work, and Jacques turns the lead back over to Tony Kanaan two laps later. It's an all-out sprint now. No one can afford to hang back.
Got about 30 minutes before it rains. About 30 minutes. That guy's a lap down.
We got a problem in turn two. Bob Jenkins.
Car up against the wall. In turn number two, it's Marty Roth. Marty Roth, once again, the crash occurs at the south end of the racetrack.
The weather situation makes the yellow on lap 151 the make or break moment of the race. Teams have to decide on ethanol, tires, or both, or whether to come in at all.
How many of these guys do you think will pit?
We think everyone in front of us will pit. Dario and you are on the same strategy. Everybody else is off strategy. We think the rain's less than 30 minutes away.
The leader, Kanaan, gets called in when the pits open on lap 155.
Gonna put me in traffic? We're gonna have to go off on the downforce. I think everyone's going to take this here, TK. It'll get them pretty close to when the rain's going to hit here.
155 of 200 laps are complete. Kanaan is in. Hornish is in. Danica Patrick is in. Castroneves is in. The 2 of Scheckter is in. The 26 of Marco Andretti. The 10 of Weldon. The drivers who now run 1 through 4, they last pitted 12 laps earlier. That's Dario Franchitti, who is now the leader. Scott Dixon, Ryan Briscoe, and Scott Sharp all have run 12 laps on this current load of fuel.
Kanaan comes back out in 6th, but he knows he has to get back to the front in a hurry. He gets a great jump when the green comes out on lap 156.
The green flag is out. We can see the rain off to the west. What's going to happen? Dario Franchitti, we've got a yellow. A yellow. We've got a problem off of turn number 4, and it looks like one of the cars involved could be Tony Kanaan. Cristineri, who is involved here?
Tony Kanaan is rolling now after he spun out of 4 down pit road, but they tried to come through too wide, Mike. What happened, you had some of the guys who were leaders who were back in the back of the pack and they were trying to make a move too quick. I think Jacques Lozier was the guy that got pinned on the outside wall here. He collided with Tony Kanaan. TK then slid and spun, and that could be the end of a dream for Tony Kanaan.
Kanaan makes an amazing save, but his hopes of winning the 91st Indianapolis 500 are gone.
As we continue to watch this weather system approach from the west, Donald Davidson, I'm not sure how far that shopping center is here in Speedway from where we are, but certainly it looks like that no more than 1 air mile from where we stand in the Bombardier Learjet Pagoda, the rain is beginning to fall just to our west.
It's probably about a mile and a half at the most.
It's Brad Keady's turn to do the rain dance. Rains are so close, the track may not stay dry to the green flag. If it does, it will be a trophy dash to the end.
Dario Franchitti is the leader of the 91st Indianapolis 500. He has 18 laps on this load of fuel. Can Dario Franchitti make it work as the two Penske cars touch, as the green flag flies? We're heading to turn number one.
Sarah Fisher does get out of the way, and here comes Franchitti, and Dixon goes right along with him. Third spot belongs to Ryan Briscoe, and here come the Penske cars.
They're two abreast as Elio Castroneves picks off another one. This thing isn't over till it's over.
Big crash down the back straightaway. One car upside down. It's the 26th car of Marco Andretti. Another car into the wall. Buddy Rice starts to come to a rest right in front of us. Marco Andretti gets upside down and comes to a rest at the emergency entrance to pit road.
So with an eye on the sky and on the track, Dario Franchitti holding on to the top position. Here's good news. Marco Andretti climbing out of the car. Give him a round of applause over there. He's out of the car waving to the fans. He's okay. Incredible effort by Marco Andretti today.
Dixon missed his chance at Franchitti on the restart. He wants to know just one thing.
What's that weather doing?
Guessing 10 minutes.
If you get another chance at it, make the best of it.
It's a chance Scott Dixon will never get.
Moisture is cool.
Hey, great restart, bud. Great job.
Wow, was that close or what?
As the safety team works to clean up the accident in the backstretch, the rains come down to wash it all away. Dario Franchitti has won the Indianapolis 500.
And look at the sheer excitement in the cockpit of that car.
This is incredible, the number of people that are still standing in this driving rain there to salute Dario Franchitti.
When I saw him on the grid, and I never tell what I say, but today it's fitting, I said, babe, just pick him off one at a time. And that's exactly what he did. And I'd like to point out that he raced from 14th to first like a gentleman. And that's exactly what my husband is. And I am so proud of him. And this is overdue for him.
Our idea was to get out there and just go for it. We knew there was another front coming in, or another squall. So it was just a matter of timing. And you always roll the dice with the weather. And thankfully, this time it cooperated with us. Unbelievable. It happened so few times in a guy's career. And you just got to savor it.
Who'd have thought it? Who would have thought it? I gotta thank my team. I gotta thank all these guys here, the whole Andretti Green Nation. This man here, this is for him. Beautiful. Can you believe it? Here he comes. Come here, you. Come
you.
Here.
I love you, man.
I keep looking on my shoulder, looking for someone else. You push so hard, you come to this race, and you put your whole, everybody puts their whole life into it, and I've dreamed about winning this thing ever since I came here. I didn't have an appreciation for it the first year, but by God, have I got an appreciation for it now. Come here.
I love you, brother.
I love you.
Are you
hurting. Okay? You okay?
Yeah, bro. I'll be hurting. Bro.
Dario Franchitti closes another chapter of the greatest spectacle in racing. As the celebration continues, the shadows grow long across the front stretch of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, ready and waiting for a little more history to be made next May.